Good evening, everyone. How are you all? Excellent. You can't see my knees knocking behind this, so. But just to say thank you very much for wanting to come and listen to this talk. I will say that it's still a work in progress, because I find myself always doing these things in terms of researching and going down rabbit holes and all sorts of things. And I find myself finding out more and more and thinking, what do I leave in and what do I take out? But this is a walk, let me tell you what I do for a day job. I'm a tour guide, so I'm more than likely out and about talking to people and walking and showing them places. But today's presentation, this evening's presentation, is entitled Little Women. That's how I advertised it. But what I wanted really to say, let me just turn it on, is we little, but we talawa. And do you know that word, phrase? No. So what it is, oh, okay, so I continue. So yes, so we little but we talawa. And what it says is, we're little, but we're strong, we're talawa. And it is a Jamaican phrase that comes out. You more likely hear it when people are talking about somebody that is small and feisty. But that's normally how I do the tour. And you're seeing three women that are there. That's why I said the little women. We have at the top, in the middle, that's Olive Morris. She's the one that I always think, when I think of that phrase, she little but she talawa, she's strong. And then to the left of her, or to her right, is Claudia Jones. And on the other side is Amanda Ira Aldridge. And it's, I thank Trudy for the suggestion of Amanda, because I didn't know much about her other than that. I knew the surname and I knew the name Ira. And I thought, I know he had children, but I didn't know much about this lady. And what I've discovered has caused me to really be excited to know a little bit more about her and the people that she met in her lifetime. But I'm going to start first with Olive. And I know this is the Streatham Society, and you're looking for things in Streatham, but you know, people do pass through, I do, all right? So I can say I'm in Streatham, and more than likely Olive did as well, but she says that her heart will always be in Brixton. She's actually buried in Streatham, Streatham Vale Cemetery. So, you know, she still is a place, you know, person that is still remembered, and if people go there, they at least they know where she is resting. But we have these images here that I wanted to sort of introduce you to. I don't know if you ever got to see The World Reimagined, but this orb that you see there, again, with the sort of image that we have of Olive there with her loudspeaker and always seen in that way. It's like a symbol of who she was in life. And what you will see also on the orb is that her heart will always be in Brixton. So The World Reimagined was a project that was put together back in 2022, and there were about 92 orbs, and it was about reimagining the world if we didn't have slavery, if we didn't have racism, if we didn't have discrimination, what the world would look like. And artists were invited to come and sort of create their piece on these orbs. There were many of them, and they ended up with the majority of them being displayed in Trafalgar Square over the week, one weekend, and it was very transformative for many people. But this now, this particular orb was displayed in Windrush Square, and then it was taken to Trafalgar Square, and now is inside the Civic Centre in the Town Hall. The one that you see on the far right, this one is now part of the new building. There used to be the Olive Morris House. If you look at the orb, you'll see the old building displayed behind her. That was demolished, and then they rebuilt it. They rebuilt on that site with some accommodation, and the bottom part, they now have the Lambeth Archives. And they put this lovely piece there, again, to remind people that it was originally Olive Morris House. And again, you see her quote there, her heart will always be in Brixton. This is Olive Morris in the picture that you see, and it's more likely it's going to be a Neil Kenlock picture, but you can see her there, short hair, holding a sign, very, very much a sign that is saying how she feels with regards to the police. And it is a demonstration. This goes back to the late 1960s, 69. Olive Morris was born in Jamaica, but she came to this country at the age of 9 years old. She was born in 1952. She came at the age of 9 years old to join her parents. Her parents had come, as many did from the Caribbean, to come and have a new life, also to come and help rebuild the country. Now, they'd learned a lot about the ways of the British through their education, and they'd come from what were sunny climes, you know, beautiful places, people that they knew, and they came to very cold and very grey and not necessarily a very welcoming place. And for many, that, you know, was their life in terms of having to deal with that. And as a young person, you can imagine how difficult it was to assimilate when the people are not always going to be kind to you. She went to school in Battersea. She joined her parents in Battersea. She went to school in Battersea, a primary school, then a secondary school, and then she went to another secondary school that was in Tulse Hill. But she didn't have any qualifications. She left without them. But here she is. What does she do with her life? She's in Brixton. She's hanging out there. And an incident took place. And this incident took place in Cold Harbour, Atlantic Road, where the police had stopped a black man. He hadn't got the right details for his car, and they wanted to know, and he wouldn't answer. And so they took him quite forcefully to the police station. And you can imagine in Brixton, people seeing this, they're not very happy. And it was later on that Olive decided that she was going to remonstrate. And as you can see, she's remonstrating with a police officer there. But she and five other people were caught up in this demonstration. And there was something happened that they ended up being taken off to the police station. And while she was there, she was very brutally dealt with. And equally, quite frightening from her account, where because of her short hair, because of her sort of androgynous look, they said to her, "What are you, boy or girl?" And the man held a truncheon and said, "We'll soon find out." So you can imagine, this is this 1969, you know, the early times, and people were looking to the police and seeing now, you know, they weren't really very good at policing, nor very good with the black community. She was taken from there to St. Thomas's Hospital. There was visible bruising, but that was her recollection of the police, and also something that sort of put a fire in her belly as such. Now, interesting enough, that incident didn't go unnoticed, and it was discussed in the Houses of Parliament, in the House of Commons. And there is a record of it, as they do with everything that is said in the Parliament, in Hansard's. And it was the Member of Parliament for this area asking the then Home Secretary, James Callaghan, was it the way that police should manhandle people who, and this gentleman that wouldn't speak, turned out to be a Nigerian diplomat and wasn't prepared to sort of discuss his business with the police. Is it expected that the diplomats should behave in this way, or even black people to be treated in the way that he'd heard from those people who had been arrested, the six people? And so Callaghan defended that, you know, he's expecting diplomats to behave in a particular way as they've come to a country, and there are laws to observe, even though they won't necessarily always be sort of cooperative. But there you are. So that is the incident. Now, I'm showing you this particular image of Owad. Now, Olive Morris, as I said, she had a fire in her belly. And given all the demonstrations against police behavior and brutality, we have in the 70s a movement that is inspired by another movement in America, the Black Panthers. And she joins the Black Panthers. And she joins others who joined it. There was Neil Kenlock, there was Linford Kwesi Johnson, Darkus Howe, Farouk Dundee, and a friend of hers, Liz Obi, that was a longtime friend. And so they were able to go to demonstrations, they were able to go out there and campaign, you know, for against discrimination and police brutality. But the Black Panthers eventually folded in 1973. And Olive Morris decided that they were going to set up an organization quite separate to the Black Panthers that they felt was a bit misogynistic. And I do, in a way, understand. We do have a lot of testosterone that's out there that needs to be sorted out. But they didn't like that environment, and they felt that they needed to leave from there and set up their own group. And they set up what was the Brixton Black Women's Group. And apparently it was the first organization of its kind in Britain. So by setting up this group, it wasn't just about women coming together and talking about political matters. It was about normal things, about housing, education, their children, childcare, food. And people were starting to come to them to ask for help and advice. Now, where they set this group up was in Railton Road, 121 Railton Road. But they also set up, quite later on in 1978, another organization that you can see here with the card there, OWAD, which is the Organization for Women of African and Asian Descent. And that was set up, again, it was non-hierarchical, and they wanted very much, again, to have discussions about women's lives and the quality of life. And this is in the time when you had the burn the bra sort of events, and women, white women, I say, that were out there basically wanting their rights as feminists, but it didn't always include those black women and other cultural groups in terms of their women wanting to have a voice and have a say. So they were quite separate in that. But this actually was, this card and the membership card was placed in an exhibition called The Women in Revolt at the Tate Britain. That's where I found it. And I had that same thought when I was there about the feminist movement, in terms of it was very much white middle class and wanting various things, but we didn't see black women being represented. And then I came across this and I said, yes, this is what I was looking for. And what you will see there in the right-hand side is OWAD and the membership card for Stella Dadsey, who was also a friend of Olive Morris, because she came and joined her in this organization. And she has number 4. I don't know who had number 1 to 3, but sure, it might be sort of in the box that was given by Stella Dadsey, the archive box to the Black Cultural Archives. Now, I don't know if any of you have been along Railton Road, but they had a playground there called Dexter's Playground. And they had lots of panels that were there sort of giving information about black history and various personalities. And there was one that was, and you can see here, this was the Squatter's Handbook. And this is Olive Morris climbing up a wall. And I remember seeing this many, many years ago, long before this playground. It was a booklet. And I was in housing, and squatters in those days, in the 80s, you were able to squat. It's no longer allowed. It's illegal now. But she had a passion in terms of, yes, women's rights, but also housing. And in Lambeth, there was a very big issue around housing. Many of you might remember the Kathy Come Home movie that was on the television, sort of showing and highlighting some of the difficulties of housing. Can you imagine if you were somebody that had come from the West Indies or from another country trying to get housing? It was very difficult, and the type of housing you were going to get wasn't always good, and equally, you were going to more than likely find that the landlord wasn't caring about you either. So she was going out to look for empty properties and to basically move in. And 121 Railton Road was the place that they found and squatted soon after leaving the Black Panthers. And that squat became known as the Anarchist Centre. And everybody that went there were groups, community groups, that were able to find a place where they can sit, talk, sort out issues. And can you imagine, from 1973 to 1999, they had this place, all right, for the community. And it wasn't, the council couldn't get it back because each time they rebuffed them. And it was interesting because, as you can see, with Olive on the right-hand side, she's looking very menacing there. And that's why I said to you, she's little, but she's talua. She's strong. There she is telling somebody, I don't know if it's the landlord or somebody that's coming to try and repossess the property, but she's letting him know. And they were able to rebuff attempts three times of the people coming to get the property. She moved out from there, but the place became a center for advice and is still very much a place where people say, go down to 121. It's now a place where history was made. There are many organizations that started there, many movements and people getting help and assistance in various ways at 121 Railton Road. So, just going back to the booklet, if you do find one of those booklets, hold on to it. There are people that are interested in knowing about that book. I would say to round tables, they want that book, that booklet. And I know this. There's the booklet they have is at Lambeth Archives. They have a collection of Olive Morris's papers there. And there is Olive Morris, a beautiful face there, beautiful face. Sadly, Olive Morris died 12th of July, 1979. She had cancer. Can you imagine what she had done in 27 years of her life in terms of being in Jamaica, coming to this country, and very much, you know, setting up groups and movements and meeting people that really, you know, transformed her life and others as well. She didn't just stay in Brixton. She got a degree in Manchester and continued sort of enlarging her life and going abroad. She went to China, of all places, because in the 70s, communism and socialism and Marxism were very much the things that were driving people in looking for equality and people's rights. So she went to China. She even tried to get to Africa, and she only got as far as Algeria and had to ask that British Commission to get her home because they couldn't get any further. But this is the person that she was. And the mural that you see on the right-hand side there, well, again, walking around, you have to walk in places and discover these things. Because I sometimes wander around, and I came from Railton Road through a little side path, and I came into this opening, and I turned around, and there was this mural. Wonderful mural. And you can see the similarity with the picture. They've used the picture, and Neil Kenlock's picture, and they've used it there. And what you see is that she was, again, ahead of her time. And they call her, you know, a campaigner, you know, a fighter. She's everything. And this was actually put in as part of what was called the 81 Acts of Exuberant Defiance. And exuberant defiance, in a way, and 81 reflects back to 1981. When we had what was called a riot, but also is referred to as an uprising. So if you go into Brixton, you talk about the riots in 1981, just be careful, all right? They'll say, no, it was an uprising. So it is very much, still very much in people's minds, and it's in our history. Black history isn't just about black people, it is British history, but it's finding a way to get people to understand the circumstances that lead to many of these events. I'm sure if Olive Morris had lived, she would have been out there fighting again for it. But this was part of their project, and they had an artist called Lynette Kamala. I'm saying Kamala because I'm hearing Kamala Harris, and I don't want to be wrong. It could be Kamala, but Lynette Kamala. And she did some work with some young ladies who are part of what is called the Olive Morris Collective. And also the WOM Collective, which a group of female street muralists. Again, they could not get into the world of street murals because it was a male-dominated environment, so they set up their own collective, and they do amazing work, now seen as part of community activities. But this is their work, and I hope that it stays for a long while, because again, it's a mark of who we have as our people that fight on our behalf, fight for the rights of many people. And hopefully her memory will continue. They are going to continue, I know they will. But Google always gets in there somewhere. We're going to see three Google images of the women I'm going to talk about today. And so this artwork was done in 2020. And as you can see, it shows Railton Road, 121 Railton Road, and you can see the people there. And this is where she set up her groups, and this is where many other people got a chance to enjoy that space for their own personal, you know, groups and campaigns. Now, the next one is just to give you an announcement that an event is going to be taking place on the 30th of this month. Sadly for me, I won't be able to be there, but it'll be the unveiling of a blue plaque at 121 Railton Road. And it is to commemorate Olive Morris. And I think, again, she's made it. When you have a blue plaque, you know, on a wall, she's made it. But the unveiling will take place on that day. So they're asking people to gather there about 11:15. So for any of you that are interested in blue plaques and where they are located, do go along, even if it's after the event, at least to see that blue plaque and know that it is about somebody and their worth. But there's also going to be another event on the 12th of October, again about Olive Morris. And it is going to be at the Caribou Education Centre. And it is where they're going to have an Olive Morris Memorial Awards ceremony. And it will be very much a ceremony that is also to highlight the work of Olive Morris and also the next community activists. So they've been doing it about 3 years. It hasn't been continuously 3 years, but they're very much wanting to keep her memory alive. And the keynote speaker for that is Stella Dadsey. And Stella Dadsey very much holds a lot of information around Olive Morris. And one of the things I have in my mind is, you know, what did she sound like? You know, how did she come across? It's those sort of things. You just have pictures, but what was her voice like? How did she come across? And that person is Stella Dadsey, and equally Liz Obie as well. But Stella Dadsey, she's got all her information that she did in her time as a campaigner here in London and in Lambeth, and she's given that over to the Black Cultural Archives. So that's Olive. Right. So, just to tell you a little bit about myself. When I used to have problems, my parents used to give us proverbs and sayings and quotes from poetry. We didn't see it as helpful then because we didn't understand it. And there's a phrase, again, a Jamaican phrase. It's a long word, but I'm shortening it down to grow come see. Grow come see. Understand. Yes, the long one, because you've laughed there, Dickie, is baby pig to mummy pig. Why am I so long? Grow come see. And it is about that growing and coming and seeing. But for Daddy, when I was struggling with things, he would just quote, men, great heights by great men were not attained by sudden flight, but by those who toiled upward through the night while their companions slept. And I decided to change it to women. I said to myself, we work hard, we work hard. So I just thought, and this is the person I'm going to introduce to you next. This is Claudia Jones. And Claudia Jones is a woman that clearly was someone who was working tirelessly. I'm just in awe of her energy. Despite her illness, she was a powerhouse. And that's my daddy's quote from William from Wordsworth, but one of her quotes was, people without a voice were as lambs to slaughter. So Claudia Jones, she was born in Trinidad in Port of Spain, and her family were not too badly off. Her mother had land, her father worked in the hotel, but she was born in 1915, so the First World War was still going on. But after the war, things got a bit difficult for the family, and they decided to immigrate to America. And when they got to America, you can imagine, again, a similar sort of feeling. You've come to a country that says, come, you're tired, you're huddled, and when you get there, the welcome isn't so great. And equally, the treatment, can be deadly as well in terms of because you're black and the people are not necessarily going to tolerate you. And the kind of accommodation that many immigrants find themselves in is always not necessarily the best of accommodation nor the best of areas. Her mother passes away and she is left with her father, who now has lost his job. He was working for a newspaper, has lost his job, but then is unable to find any real gainful work until he gets a job as a janitor. And the janitor's job comes with an accommodation, but it was terrible. And she developed tuberculosis because of the conditions. But in terms of education, she was a very studious young girl. And she was going to be given an award as part of the graduation ceremony that she was going to have. But she couldn't go to the graduation ceremony because her father couldn't afford to buy her a graduation outfit. So you can see that this is a person, you know, that has has plans and ambitions, but not able to always fulfill them in the way that she wanted to. But she wasn't deterred. And she found herself after school going into certain jobs that weren't really nice. She was millinery. She did some things that she felt, no, I should be doing more than this. And what she did, she wanted to progress. So she joined the Communist Party. This is America we're talking about. And she joins the Communist Party, but the youth section. But she also joins the junior NAACP. That's the National Association of Colored People. But she was going on campaigning because she could see that, you know, people needed to have a better life, rights and freedom, you know, to do as they feel fit to help themselves. So she started to get into campaigning. She was writing in the newsletters, and she also got an opportunity to travel. And she went to places, even down south, and was there at the time of what was called the Scottsboro Trials, where some young black men were accused of something, and they were going to be executed, and she was working with a group that was able to save only four of the young men. But she got more and more into the Communist Party and writing and being an editor to the newsletters and going on campaigns, and she came to the attention of the FBI. I tell you, that tells you you're really dangerous, you know, when you get to the FBI, and I'm being facetious there, but anyway. And so she came to their attention, and this is now late 40s, and they were following her and other people around, and by doing this research, I found her file online, or a file online, and there was a memo from the man himself, J. Edgar Hoover, to the embassy here in London at Grosvenor Square. And the content of the letter, of the memo, is all redacted, so you can't see what's there. But by the fact that that document is there, referring to her by J. Edgar Hoover, tells you, you know, she was somehow seen as a problem. But she had traveled from Jamaica, from Trinidad with her family, but she hadn't been naturalized. And so what they did, they put her into prison several times, and then they eventually decided they were going to deport her. And what they decided, that they believed her activities were deemed un-American. Under McCarthyism, as it was, she was tried as an alien and a subversive. And under the Alien Registration or Smiths Act, she was going to be deported back to Trinidad. But Trinidad didn't want her. The governor said, no, 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 she's going to be trouble. But she didn't want to go to Trinidad either. She may have been born there, but she knew nothing about there. But she felt that she could do more in England. So she decided to come to the UK. And it's interesting because the governor didn't want her, and he sent a memo to the civil servant saying that she'll be a bit of a problem. And that unnamed civil servant says, yes, we know, we have a worry. You can imagine, as I said, women, yes, we're little, we're talawa, they worry. So she came to Britain in 1955, and again, you know, she said about trying to get back into the Communist Party here, found it very difficult because she was black. So it tells you, even though the Communist Party was a party that had invited her back in the States, they weren't so welcoming here. So she started to look for ways to continue campaigning. And she started to see the people that were coming from the Caribbean who were experiencing great difficulties here in terms of housing, racism, sexism, all the sort of things that, you know, she thought, I can do something. And she started to go and meet people in various groups, and she started to realize the British were a bit, I wouldn't call them, well, those who were here that came from the Caribbean, they were a bit slow. She felt that they needed to have a little bit more oomph. So she was out there, she was going to various places, and she was doing quite a lot to galvanize, you know, people and tell them that you can, you know, be, you know, do more if you're together as groups. So various groups started to set up, but she just kept on going. And the picture that you see there is of her first sort of major project that she set up, and that was in 1958. That was the West Indian Gazette, and that was the first black newspaper here in Britain. What you see on the right-hand side is an image, it's me and a sort of sculpture there of Olive Morris. Of Claudia, and it's done in metal, and the artist is Favour Johnson. And she decided to do it in metal because she believed that women, when they put under pressure, we yield a bit, but we come back, we snap back. But yes, so she had the West India Gazette, and there were various people that were writing for it. They didn't get paid, but they felt they were doing a, you know, great service for people. But she kept on firing on. But we come to, as I said, 1958, and we're looking now to Notting Hill. And I thought I'd blow these images up because you'll see them a bit more and a bit in your face, because that's how people felt in Notting Hill. You were going about your business and you had young men, teddy boys, coming up to you, assaulting your wife, you know, being rude to your children and basically telling you to go home. But you'd come because you'd been asked to come. And these were mainly working class white families who were living in the Notting Hill area, who were not comfortable with the idea that their neighbours were black, weren't always happy that the way that the men would strut on a Sunday through the streets, thinking they owned the place. And you had a gentleman who saw an opportunity to take advantage of people's dislike of the West Indian community and try to get himself a seat in Parliament, and that was Oswald Mosley. So you'll see on the left-hand side, this is the police in Notting Hill trying to arrest a young white youth, and there's people gathering around. And then you'll see, and I think it may well be Trafalgar Square, but you can see the banner there of the Black National, so the White Defence League. They were very prevalent in the Notting Hill area, and Oswald Mosley was using them also to try and garner, you know, the young men to go out and sort of basically assault people. The police weren't always helpful because they were also feeling that they didn't really want these new people there. So it was people were caught between the rock and a hard place for much of that time. And so she was trying to get the government to try and do something. So she, again, was meeting with people and saying, you've got to do something. And the government saying, well, we're looking at this and trying our best, and the police are doing their best. But things weren't going as she felt they were, and at a pace. And she felt that she had also, there was riots in Nottingham as well, race riots in Nottingham. So she was in various parts of the country trying to galvanize people to deal with discrimination. And she goes, we've got to do something in London to get the stench of these riots out of our noses. And the decision was to have a carnival. She wasn't a carnival person. She had not had the sort of the traditions in the US because she'd been, you know, been there most of her growing life, but a carnival. But We get to 1959. We've had the race riot. They're planning a carnival. And then this gentleman is murdered. He'd gone to get his thumb sorted out at the hospital, and on his way home, he was set upon by youths and was stabbed in the back. And as you can see, people were demonstrating in Notting Hill. And so this now meant that they wanted to really get the government to do something, but they felt that they needed also to do a sort of charm offensive. So this carnival started at the St. Pancras Hall. Many people associate Olive Morris with the Notting Hill Carnival in terms of the street carnival. That was a different lady in 1969. That was Ruth Laslett that did that, Ruin Laslett. She had done one at St. Pancras Town Hall. She got the Trinidad All-Stars steel pan to play. She had Lord Kitchener come in. She even had other people that we don't know about. Nadia Katus, again, an actress. I know there are names of people that were here, but we didn't know them. They were in the show business. Cy Grant, all these people that came together. And one of the things that makes me smile, it was recorded, and it was on the radio, BBC, on the BBC, and it was recorded, but they no longer have any recording of that in their records, so it's gone. But what they also did with that carnival was to have people pay to attend it, and to that money was going to go towards the legal fees for those young black men who had been arrested and were going to court. So, what they thought about in terms of celebration, this is a very dull reference by, I say dull, by Claudia. The people's art is the genesis of their freedom. But for somebody else, they said the carnivals, that's the tradition, you know, and that's the best way for democracy. But this is the carnival, one of the pictures I could get from the internet without causing too much trouble. But you can see people enjoying themselves. And if you can imagine the interesting costumes that they were wearing, they even had a beauty competition. And the beauty competition, people are thinking, why are you having a beauty competition? But you have to understand from a black perspective, you know, people are looking at you because of your skin color. But if you parade it, it goes back to that 1960s phrase of black is beautiful. It helps people to feel good about themselves and to enjoy the event. This event, the first one was a success, and they decided to put one on. They put three more on in different places. So again, you're seeing how you know, they were trying to address some of the difficulties between the communities. And they invited white people there. There is a gentleman, a white gentleman in there. He attended. So it also shows you that it was open to everyone. It wasn't exclusively those from the West Indies. Now, this is putting all these together. So I'm going to start sort of clockwise. We start at the top left, and we're looking at Claudia Jones with Paul Robeson. And beside Paul Robeson is Amy Garvey. Amy Garvey was the editor for the West Indian Gazette on behalf of Claudia Jones. And to the right or the left of Amy Garvey was Paul Robeson's wife, Islanda. And then you have the mayor of Lambeth there. Now, I didn't know this, but Paul Robeson actually sang at Lambeth Town Hall. So I know. So I now have to go and find out what was he singing, because that was a surprise to me. But yes, because I know he sang here in Streatham, at the theatre, but I didn't know that he sang at the town hall. So that's why they're together. To the right of that picture, you have Malcolm X, and he's holding up a newspaper. Now, he was invited by Claudia Jones to an event in Birmingham, but sadly she'd passed away by the time he had arrived here. She died on Christmas Eve. 1964. He'd come in February 1965, and so he was given this newspaper that showed the Gazette with Claudia Jones in terms of her death. So this is quite a significant photograph because he came to an event that was on the 12th of February in Birmingham, and then he went back to the United States. And then 9 days later, he was assassinated. So, you know, the significance of that photo with him and Claudia there. And then we have the Royal Mail in 2008. They had a sort of special issue of Women of Distinction. And this is Claudia Jones there, a woman of distinction. She was seen as an activist, a civil rights activist. But interestingly enough, in that collection is somebody that was her friend, Barbara Castle. So you paid 72 pence for Claudia Jones, and Barbara Castle's postage stamp was 81 pence. All right, just a little bit of fun there. But she was seen, again, by having her there in that particular collection, she was seen as somebody that, you know, it was rightly deserved in terms of her contribution, in terms of dealing with, you know, getting people's rights, whether it be race, gender, class, just to get people activated. And then you see the Google again. And this was put in 2020, 14th of October 2020. And the theme was journalism and social justice. And I looked at where it was actually shown, and it was not in America, by the way. It was in the US Virgin Islands and in UK. So censored. Now, sadly, she dies alone in her home in North London. And what you see there is a memorial service that was held for her in her passing. And there was quite a number of people that attended. And we have Mrs. Oliver Tambo. Can you remember? Her husband was in Robben Island. Claudia campaigned also for Nelson Mandela to be set free. And we have Kwame Arma. He was the High Commissioner of Ghana. We've got Earl Cameron, Nadia Katouz, and we have several others. I can't see in there, but there are quite a number of people that she knew. And they had this, and they had words also conveyed by Paul Robeson to that event as well. But they then did a march up to Golders Green, and where her body was cremated. And she was then interred in Highgate Cemetery, opposite her hero, Karl Marx. That was her intention. She wanted to be buried near Karl Marx. And what we have with the memorial, with the tombstone, is it says, Claudia Vera Jones, born 1915 to 1964, died 1964, valiant fighter against racism and imperialism, who dedicated her life to the progress of socialism and the liberation of her own black people. The West India Gazette didn't survive. It basically closed after 6 months. There are references to Claudia Jones. We have Claudia Jones Way off Brixton Hill and other places now where her name is recorded, because she didn't just live in the area of Lambeth. She lived in other places as well. So there are blue plaques that are in various places. And many of those blue plaques are Nubian Jack blue plaques. So, you know, it just shows where she was in London. But she is still seen as a powerhouse. And they have an annual, the Union, National Union of Journalists, their Black Caucus, has an annual lecture in her name, Claudia Jones Memorial Lecture. And in November 2022 was the first time they were able to set the talks up after, because of COVID. Gary Young, he is the award-winning journalist and author, delivered the first in-person Claudia Jones Memorial Lecture. And it's hosted annually. And again, I'd love to be able to go to one of those and listen to journalists and how they see journalism and activism today. But that is how important she is. But there's also a school The Lambeth Academy that have now decided to name one of their houses. They have four houses, and they're going to call one of them House Jones. So they want their young people to know the importance of this woman. And again, in Black history, that's what we're trying to do as well, raise awareness and let people know that these people are important to the story of London, important to the story of Britain, because they played their part here as well. So the next one, just to finish off, is just to show this is at 6 Meadow Road. Vauxhall, and there it is. That is the English Heritage site. She was only there for a little while, but she couldn't pay the rent. And it was a gentleman called Fenner Brockway that had allowed her to stay there, but he needed the rent and she couldn't. She didn't earn a lot of money. And I'm finishing with this one so that you can go online, all right? It is a album by Courtney Pine, and it's called The House of Legends. And track 6, Claudia Jones, and the intro starts with Calypso. So you'll start dancing before it gets all the funny stuff in the middle. That's avant-garde jazz for you. But this is the first two. We've got another one, but this is now the intermission. So I think you can now get some tea, some strong coffee. And then we'll start again. I think it's about 20 minutes, is that right? So from one piece of music, advice about music, we've got my presentation now. So this quote, life without music would be unbearable. Who said that? So this is Amanda Aldridge, Amanda Ira Aldridge. Her father was Ira Aldridge. He was the first Black man to play Shakespeare's Othello on the stage. He'd come from America because it wasn't safe to do any sort of plays in that country. You'd basically lose your life. And he was encouraged by the theater manager of the Black Theater to come to England. And so he came as an 18-year-old and started to go in the provincials and start to get his acting sort of muscles. And then Edmund Kean was unwell, and he was invited to play Othello. And you would have thought that people would have been glad to have seen him playing Othello as a Black man. No, it wasn't good. It wasn't good. They complained about his lips, the size of his lips and his tongue and his look. And that very much meant that he felt that he could no longer be in the West End, as we call it today, and went and started to do his acting career and pursue his acting in Shakespearean roles in the provincials. And he was then able to travel the world. When I say the world, he was going off to Europe, went to Russia and various places, and they were giving him praise, high praise. But he had a family. And that family he was working for were left here. And this is one of the children you're looking at, Amanda. But I'm going to show you Ira. There he is. So that's Ira Aldridge and his wife, Amanda Paulina von Brandt Aldridge. And the von was supposed to give her the kudos that she was possibly Swedish royalty, but she wasn't. She was just an ordinary person and just basically decided, I want to be better. So there she is. And these are her children. So we have, well, not her child, this is Ira's child from a relationship, Ira Daniel Aldridge. Now, he very much had a troubled sort of upbringing because, as you do, if you know most celebrities, their children sort of go off a bit. That was him. He ended up going to getting into a lot of trouble and ended up going to Australia. He was a fraudster and did all sorts of criminal things. And sadly for him, his life didn't go very well. Found himself in prison a lot. The other young man is Frederick Olaf Aldridge. And he was a very accomplished pianist. He even accompanied his sisters when they were doing their singing concerts. But sadly for him, I think from what we hear, he had a mental distress and out of a window. So that wasn't good. And we come to the devoted sisters, Lorana and Amanda. Lorana, she was a very accomplished singer. She had a beautiful deep contralto voice, so good that they were going to put her into the Wagner Bayot concerts, the Wagner Bayot concerts. But sadly for her, she became unwell and couldn't continue. And she started to have a lot of ill health through her life and had crippling rheumatism. And it was Amanda that would take care of her sister. And so much so that times that she would give up the work that she was doing in order to take care of her sister. So we go to Amanda. So Amanda was born in 1866. And she, her mother saw that she had a great talent and was able to get her into singing talent and was able to get her into the Royal College of Music. And imagine being taught by Jenny Lind. Now, I only knew of Jenny Lind after seeing The Greatest Showman on Earth, all right, and listening to what is a modern version of a very good singer. But she was known as the Swedish Nightingale. But she also knew Amanda's father, Ira. And so she taught her to sing and to compose. And she was also the only person that Jenny Lind gave a sort of a reference for. And I'll just find the quote. Let me just find the quote. Sorry, here it is. So she had nothing but praise for her. She said, I found her during the whole of that time studious, intelligent, and attentive, and being musically gifted also. So she did very well. She was, her talent really much, when she sang at Crystal Palace, they may have a hall there, she was singing, you know, operettas. And she continued with her sister singing in various places. One of them was called St. James's Hall in we call the West End. But sadly for Amanda, over time, she caught laryngitis, and that was the end of her singing career. But she'd been taught well at the Royal College of Music because she was also able to do composing, and also she discovered that she could be a good tutor because Jenny Lind said to her, even when you don't have a voice, all right, know how to be a good tutor to get other people to be able to sing and speak well. So that was very good advice. So she started her career, as I said, in singing and ended up as an elocution and vocal coach. And she found herself teaching diction, including Countess of Dunmore, Lady Helen Nutting. I learned a little bit about her today too, and Lady Eileen Wellesley. And for those of you that know the name Wellesley, that's the Duke of Wellington's name. It was the fourth Duke's wife. So she was taking on some good people there. But she also decided that she wanted to compose music. And this is the time when women were not even allowed to write, you know, books. They had to disguise their talent by having a male name in order to pursue their careers. And she chose the name of Montague Ring. And what you see there is Amanda, but as Montague Ring, as she put her, you know, she put her name. And what you'll see there again is another picture of one of the booklets of her music called Corinda. But she had another one that was her favorite, was the Three African Dances. And both of those pieces of music are now in the Library of Congress, on the Congress website. But she liked the African the Three African Dances, because it explored what she felt was her ethnic heritage. She was mixed race, but she was very conscious of the African part of her, and she liked to find a way of putting those rhythms into her music. And she had, this one was Three African Dances, was inspired by West African drums, and it was considered to be her most famous piece. So, we've got Clorinda there, we've got Montague Ring. She had over 30 pieces of music composed, and I would invite you to find some of that music on YouTube. As much as she composed it between 1915 and 1925. I have to say, 1907 to 1915, I have to say I struggled. It's an interest, I can't explain it, but it just didn't work for me. Because the music was geared towards those people who have a piano at home and not necessarily as talented with their vocals. And I was listening to this music and I'm thinking, no, it's not coming in. Not good at all. Sorry, Amy. Amanda, sorry. So you're looking at one of her students here. This is Paul Robeson, but he's in the role of Othello because he became the second black man to be on the stage here in London to play that role of Othello. And this was in the 1930s. And was 60 years between. Imagine the, you know, the sort of concerns of him being there, a black man, and whether he was going to kiss his love. But he took lessons from Amanda, and they had Amanda and his wife, Islandi, you know, took on a very good sort of pen pal relationship, writing to each other. And she also, Islandi, kept a diary. And what I see here, what I was shown was an entry that revealed what Islandi had said. She said, "Spent the afternoon with Miss Amanda Ira Aldridge and enjoyed every minute of it. She is the most charming, interesting, lovable woman. She gave us her father's stage earrings that he wore as Othello, and said she hoped Paul would wear them when he played the role." And apparently Amanda had heard Robeson sing on the radio just 2 days before they had their meeting, and had written to Eslander, known as Essie, and said how wondrously beautiful Mr. Paul's voice sounded just now, and how absolutely distinct his softest tones in both singing and speaking were. Everyone will be looking eagerly forward to his next broadcasting. It is the most beautiful voice, and altogether his renderings were so artistic. And it's interesting that at the time of her death, Amanda had included in her possessions a photo of Paul Robeson, and it was inscribed to Miss Aldridge, "With many thanks for the fresh inspiration received from all reports of her father's greatness. I realize that I can only carry on the tradition of Aldridge." Marian Anderson. Now, this is someone, again, in terms of black history, American history, is a very famous singer. And she also sought out Amanda's services when she came to London in 1925. And she was pleased with the results, and she wrote a letter to Amanda. "The things you have taught me come in mighty handy just now, and all those who have heard feel that there is a decided improvement." But for Marian Anderson, she'd come to this country, with many artists did from America, to be able to perform and perform safely and not with all the sort of racism they experienced back home. They were much lauded. Many artists came here and took advantage of the sort of nicer environment, and also took lessons from various singing coaches who happened to be black. And that's, again, another sort of area of investigation. But again, going back, Anderson, despite the box office attraction she had here in this country, when she returned to America in 1934, she faced similar prejudice and hostility that Amanda's father had experienced when he had been living in America. And she had gone to, she was going to be singing at a concert hall in Washington. And when the owners found out that she was going to be singing, they refused to accept the booking. And this sparked widespread condemnation. And in answer to the protests, the United States Department of Interior, with the encouragement from the First Lady, Eleanor Roosevelt, scheduled a concert on the steps of Lincoln's Memorial on the 9th of April, 1939. And that Easter Sunday program drew a crowd of 75,000 people and millions on the radio. But she also sang, Marian Anderson also sang at President Kennedy's inauguration. So we have all these sort of links back to Amanda in terms of encouraging her to sing. Now, the lady at the bottom right there, Ida Shepley, I didn't know anything about her. But she also was somebody that took advantage of Amanda's skill to help improve their vocals. She, Ida Shepley was not just a singer, she was an actress. And she was known as the bronze girl with a golden voice. Now, she was born in Nantwich, and I forgot to find out where Nantwich was, but I know it's here in this country somewhere. but she's not remembered now. As I said, I didn't know that she existed. But she appeared in a number of shows in the 1930s, and in one that was called An All-Colored Cast, which was a production of All God's Chillen Got Wings. But she also appeared on the BBC, in the early 50s, and she was also a beneficiary of noted in Amanda's will, because later on in life, near in her 80s, Amanda was taken in by Ida and her husband, and she stayed with them, and sort of brought a piano and everything else. So she was living with them for quite some time. But you might know of this gentleman here on the left, Pools of London. Have you seen the film? No? Very interesting film, black and white. Gives the atmosphere when you see where it is, the Pools of London before all the modernization of the area. But it was Earl Cameron, he was from Bermuda. And he'd come, like many people, to come and sort of get a life here, but he wanted to act. And it was Ida Shepley that actually introduced him to Amanda. And so he wanted to be a professional actor, and his very first film was The Pool of London. But he was a pupil of Amanda for nearly 2 years, and he was very fond of her. And his recollection of her was of a light-skinned, rather short and stocky. She was a lovely, well-spoken person, delicate and dignified, with a tremendous sense of humor. She was a courteous, beautiful human being. Now, you're looking at, again, at an article on the right-hand side that is from Muriel Smith. Now, Amanda had been doing her work as an in terms of diction, elocution, and singing tutor, but she wasn't known, well-known at all. But you can see from the names of the people that went to her, she was well-known in terms of the talent that she had and the skills to get the best out of her students. But she appeared on a BBC TV program. She was now in her 80s. And it was just 2 years before her death when her song, Little Southern Love Song, was sung by Muriel Smith. Now, Muriel Smith is an American who made her debut in Broadway in 1943, but she came to London to sing in the role of Carmen in the original opera at the Royal Opera House in Covent Garden. I think the place where she is with Muriel is in Kensington, Bedford Gardens. Now, this is one that I found, and I thought it was absolutely nice to see this one. This is the High Commissioner from Haiti. Her father was very much, even though he was an actor, he was very much involved in trying to deal with the rights of people, because he was working during a period when slavery was still legal and accepted in America. And he felt very strongly about those islands that are trying to get themselves, you know, free as well, not to be under the cosh of slavery. And one of them was Haiti, where they had a revolution then in terms of being able to be free of slavery before they were enslaved again. And so Haiti, he was given posthumously at the commission in the army of Haiti. And what you see, as I said, is the High Commissioner here bringing some gladioli to Amanda there. I found this because I have ancestry.com, so I was able to find some information that wouldn't be out there in the public domain as easily as I would like. And the thing that sort of pulled me back was that, yes, she had passed away. She was now 89 when she passed away. But it's where her last place, and that was Cane Hill. And it took me aback because I know Cane Hill was known as an asylum, and more than likely she'd gotten older and possibly, you know, may have been Alzheimer or dementia that may have affected her. But if you can see what she'd left in her will, £440 and some shillings and some pence. Some of you know about the shillings and pence, yes? And today's, it'll be about £10,000. So, in a way, you know, it's a short introduction to her, but I think there's more to discover about Amanda, because she knew people. And if I say to you, W.B. Du Bois, you know, that was a man who was very famous in his time. He was a writer, campaigner. And he'd invited her to go to the Pan-African Congress. This is a place where many people from Africa and America would come to Britain to discuss the sort of plans for getting Africa to come and be a country that many people who had been enslaved in the Caribbean and Africa, and even people here, could return to. And it was in 1921 when he came, W.E.B. Du Bois, he came, and she had to turn him down. She says, I can't, because my sister needs me. And that was Lorana. And so, as I said, it's that devotion that she had to her sister. She remained, you know, devoted to her right to the end, and she was devoted to her career. She never stopped working as a tutor. And I just want to say thank you very much by showing the last Google of her. And in a way, it's sort of Art Nouveau style, but you can see the clefts in the side there. And the theme, simple, teacher. So this is where I finish. So you've seen Amanda, a little bit about Amanda, Claudia Jones, and Olive Morris. And I don't know, I feel always when I read about these women more inspired, because I learn a little bit more about them and the times they lived in and what they had to go through. So I don't know about you, but I just hope that you do feel inspired. Okay, thank you very much.